Well, good morning. Thank you for attending this workshop called Learning to Read in Adulthood, What Makes It Happen? My name is Catherine Troca, and I'm a tutor. I've been a tutor for about 20 years, and I also train people to be tutors. But I had a wonderful experience where I was able to interview 11 people, 11 new adult readers, 6 women and 5 men, and they all had struggled with reading when they were in school, but they are feeling comfortable with reading as adults. So my question to them was, what made the difference? You know, it was a trouble when you were a child, but now you're finding some success. So what was it that helped you to be successful as an adult? The answers that I got from these 11 people were really not surprising, because all of what they told me were things that were well-established educational principles. But what makes it powerful is that it came from adult learners. This was what they said helped them. And that's what I was looking for. What helped you? Not what the book said for tutors to do, but what helped you as an adult learner? Now, these are the findings. This is what they told me helped them to read. One-to-one tutoring. So, versus a classroom. Phonics was the second thing. Having a purpose, a reason. This was motivation. And the last one I've listed here is high expectations for success. Okay, we're going to look at each one of those individually, and these three people specifically had something to say about one-to-one tutoring. And I'm going to need to get my paper here, because I want to read to you exactly what they said. So May, the one who'd been in a literacy program and then went to an adult school, she said, it's the one-to-one, and you work at your own pace. Now, Jay had a lot to say about this. He said, if you stumbled, you didn't have to wait until 3 or 4 people were done with the teacher. By the time they got to you, you forgot about it, and you were already gone on to something else. And privacy, you feel intimidated with a bunch of people, or you think they're better than you and you're under stress and you have a tendency to mess up more. And Connie said, it's working one-on-one with my tutor. Okay, any comments now about this on one-to-one tutoring? How many of you have been in a one-to-one tutoring?
I have. And it helped me a lot.
Okay.
I seem to different myself.
So the one-to-one tutoring you feel really has helped
you? Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know, yes.
Okay. Can you tell me more about that? Why?
Well, you don't feel so intimidated like that person say you are involved. You don't feel like, oh my God, who's gonna see me? Who is that? You just work, just you and that person. And like you say before, you have to open up and take it one little at a time. That's what I got it.
So those of you who have had one-to-one tutoring, do you think that part of intimidation when you're around other people, that makes sense to you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just you and your teacher alone.
Pardon me?
Just you and your teacher alone.
Just you and your teacher alone, right. Your teacher, your tutor, whatever.
Yeah, I feel the opposite.
Okay.
I like more, I never had too much one-on-one, mm-hmm. but when I joined the literacy program, I found that there were other people who weren't even as good as I was, which made me feel even better that I wasn't the only one who couldn't read well or sound out words. So it was okay to make a mistake.
Okay.
Where one-on-one, that person is smart and they're helping you, and I felt more intimidated that they're gonna think I'm stupider because they don't know why I don't know the words. Where other people, if you do it kind of in a smaller group, other people are making mistakes, so you're more free to make a mistake. You're
okay.
Not working as hard to cover up.
Thank you very much. Anybody can relate? And your name, you've
Mindy.
Got a Mindy. To what?
Mindy.
Mindy. to what Mindy said?
Well, everybody had different opinion. Like
right.
You say, that's her experience. Like I said,
right.
I wouldn't be here if it was for the library, my 101.
Right.
Take a different right. class. I've been in Miracosta College in one kind of class, and I'm down in group. But to, you know, everybody had her niche. That's her niche, and she liked to,
that's
it. It worked for her, and everybody learned different. And, you know, good, it worked for you. Keep doing it. Why not?
Exactly. And that's a good point, that everybody learns differently. That's
I have deflection too, aside.
And as a tutor, a trainer of tutors, this is what I try to get across to the new tutors, that everybody learns differently. That's so important. And remember I told you about May. Now, she started out in a one-to-one, and then she went to the class because she needed that, just what you were talking about, Mindy. She needed to have that experience with other learners. Okay, anything else on the one-to-one? We can always bring these up later, too, as we're finishing up. All right, the next one was phonics. So, what do I have? Five people up there. And Carl said, and he'd been in several reading clinics, and he compared the reading clinics to the library literacy program. And he said, it just got down to the basics, sounding out words. Because I guess in the reading clinics, they kind of fluffed past the phonics. And he thought phonics is what really helped him. And Ben said, once you have the phonetics explained to you, it makes sense. It all fits together. And Bill, it's mostly the sounds. I'm more relaxed now. I have a lot more interest in wanting to read. And Connie, understanding the sounds gives me more confidence. If I see something and I have to read it, I'm not afraid to try. Now, Rose, she was really an interesting person. Rose was an artist. And she, when she would see words, all she saw was shapes. She didn't, or even letters. That's what she looked at, was the shape. It had no connection with anything else other than just what the shape was. So she said, any reading I could do before was certainly sight reading. I didn't know the sounds of the letters, but my tutor was patient enough to go over the sounds of the letters. The words were just shapes to her. Now, how many of you are familiar with the book, The Teacher Who Couldn't Read?
By John Corcoran.
By John Corcoran. Right, okay.
I'm speaking about him.
You, pardon me?
I wrote, he's part of my what I've been going through, yes. It's an awesome book.
It certainly is. And if you haven't read it or have become acquainted with it, because it's, as an avid reader, this was a page turner to me. Once I got this book, I couldn't put it down.
Where do you find the book?
Well, our literacy program, I know, has it.
And really?
It might be in some, and this is in Placer County or Sacramento County. And do you know if they have it in the libraries here, Jackie?
They could ask their literacy coordinator, I'm sure they would have a copy.
Yeah. Okay.
But this is a man from, he's from San Diego. And I heard him speak one time in Sacramento. And fascinating to listen to this man speak. And the reason I'm talking about him under phonics is that I heard him tell about one of the problems that he had with reading. And
but how can you be a teacher if you can't?
Okay, hang on. You're getting ahead of me here. Part of it was his personality, though. He was one of these jovial people who could kind of glad hand everybody. Now, I'm not putting jocks down, but he was an athlete. And he insists that it wasn't his athletics that got him where he was. But I don't know. I
don't you need a degree, though, to graduate?
He graduated from college. Yes, ma'am. So you have to read the book to find out. But the reason I'm talking about him under phonics is he went to a library literacy program in San Diego, and he had always been confused with two letters. He'd always been confused with the letter M, and the letter N. Now, does anybody recognize this book that I'm holding up? Laubach Way of Reading? Some of you in the literacy program start with this book. And it's a step-by-step. It starts off with the, you know, every letter and the sound of every letter. And when John Corcoran got to the M and N, so here's the M for man and the N for neck. He'd been confused by that since he was a little kid. And it just snowballed. But once he got to a library literacy program, it made sense to him, and that's what got him going then to continue with literacy. He got over that big hump of that simple little thing. And as trainers, you know, we don't know those kinds of things. So I was just delighted to hear him tell about that, because we were saying before, people learn in different ways. And as trainers, we don't know these little pieces that are missing in people's backgrounds. Purpose. Having a purpose. Now I need to get to my next page here. All right, this is what Jake said about purpose. If I can find it, okay. Jake saw no reason to read as he was growing up. Now here's another one who was an athlete. Other people would help him get what he needed. And he was, again, one of these outgoing kind of people, and he had the girls doing what he wanted. And so a lot of things in school, he had other people do for him. But when he was an adult, his employer discovered his reading problem, and he lost his job. So then he really did have a purpose to learn to read. Now, this was a man who, he came from a moderately wealthy family, and his parents had him paid for tutors for him when he was in school. But he really didn't care. He wasn't interested in learning any of that kind of stuff. And this was a time of the Vietnam War, and he was drafted. So when he was drafted, he went to Vietnam, and he was a corpsman. That's what they did. They had him as a corpsman. And when he came back, his only experience, only kind of job experience, was kind of hospital work. So he was able to get a job in a hospital. And again, very friendly, and he knew how to work people, and so he got this job. And one of the jobs he had to do was to sort through medicines and put them in certain orders. And he did it by the color of the labels, because he could not read what was on the medicine bottle. So that's why he lost his job. And you know, it's a pretty dangerous thing, seems to me, to have somebody sorting their medicines by color instead of by what was on the label. Now, Jake was the one who scored like college level on the reading. And once he, discovered that he needed to know how to read in order to get a job, then he just got engulfed with reading. And he was constantly reading. And he loved to read about the Vietnam War, of all things. But he was reading all these things that was happening when he was growing up and heard about. But now he was reading them. Ellie. Now, this is my hairdresser. She said, I was always placed in special reading groups. In high school, we used these cards, different colored. I think they were called SRA. I felt like I was in first grade, and here I was a senior in high school. I taught myself to read. The way I did it was I was seeing other people read, and I wanted to read so very much. It was like this thirst I had, wanting to read. I was 23, and I wanted to read, but I didn't think I could. So someone said, read this book. And the book was called Rage of Angels by an author named Sidney Sheldon. And I read the book, and it was like I had to read constantly. And if there were words I didn't understand, I would just skip over them. Now, I did get a copy of this book, and it's a pretty thick book, but there's a lot of conversation in it, and people speak easier words than they write. So a lot of this conversation was pretty easy to read, and it's a very compelling story. So I could see why she could get caught in the story, and she just kept going and going and going. All right, Jay. Jay saw no reason to read as a child. In the child's world, he did not need reading. When he became an adult, he wanted to read to his children and be able to run his own business. High expectations. First one I have up there is a man named Carl. And he had a memory from third grade, which he shared with me during these interviews. This is what he said. I remember we were in a little circle and I was having awful problems with that, what, this, those kinds of words, and all that. And the teacher says, Carl, you'll never learn how to read. So the teacher told him.
Third grade teacher.
Yeah, I think she should have lost her teaching credential.
She should have never said that.
And so he thought, if I'm never going to read, what's the use of trying? Okay, and Jake said, Jake had concealed his reading problem for years. It ate at him. He began to feel better about himself after revealing how his reading problem had controlled him by keeping it a secret. Jake's tutor helped him to expect success with reading and to know achievement. Andy. She used to give me so much work and sometimes I didn't do it all. But she would say, okay, do the best you can. She didn't bawl you out. She expected me to do it. She knew I could do it, and after a while, you feel inside you want to do everything for this lady. Okay. Bill. She nails me with anything that I miss or mispronounce, and even if I go back and correct myself, she says that I'm reading good enough that I should get it right the first time. And she's right. She's really good. She has a lot of patience. And Gina. My tutor would say, Miss Smith, I don't mean to talk to you like this, but I know you could do better than you're doing. You could do this, you could do that, and this is when I really came out of it and I started doing better. Okay, now high expectations is the one that actually came out the strongest. It's not, I didn't list everybody in what they said, but and I'm reading or hearing an awful lot more lately about how important high expectations are. They're finding out, they're doing brain studies, and they can even pinpoint the part of the brain with an MRI that is stimulated when the person is, just with words, given some kind of high expectations that they're going to be able to do this. But this one on the high expectations is something that I've really grappled with, and I'd really like more input from you as to how can your tutor correct you and still encourage you? What?
Using their choice of words.
Okay.
Using their vocabulary, which is higher than ours, to say maybe try this again.
Okay, try this again. Now that's a good way, because that's kind of a positive way of saying it, right? Try this again.
Yeah, changing their tone of voice. Why can't you get that? Or that doesn't say that.
Okay, good
I'm
point.
I'm being so negative about it.
Right, okay. As a tutor trainer, I really want to find out from learners what helps you the most. That's my whole purpose in being here. What helps you to learn? And these things that I have up here, you know, that whole list and that you've got on your paper here, they're listed here, and there's a line down here in case there's anything that you could add that you feel has helped you this is what we're hoping to get from you as you listen to these stories of these different people. What can help you? So that you can help me when I'm training tutors. And by the way, this one program where I'm doing the training, they're changing the name of tutors to reading coach. Do you like that? Instead of tutor, being a reading coach?
Well, I did a PALS illiteracy program. Called PALS illiteracy program.
PALS illiteracy
program. I lived up in Sacramento.
And that was in Auburn?
It was in, yeah, well, it was based out of Auburn, but I was in Roseville. Rockland. I was in Rockland.
That's exactly where I go. In fact, I'm going there next Saturday to do a tutor training at PALS.
I didn't grasp on that is we would meet with a tutor at the library. We'd sit in the middle of the library or wherever, and you have people all around you, and there's no way for me to concentrate on learning that, because I'm thinking, he's looking at me, or she's making fun of me because I can't read, or, you know, there was a lot. Now, I go to the Santa Fe Springs Library, they have a private area for us to be in, and I feel more secure with the privateness.
Thank you so much for saying that, because that's a huge problem that we have with literacy, is finding places to meet and places where you can feel some privacy. Now, there's another side to this, and I'm going to tell you this story. And this happened in Rockland. I used to live in Rockland, and I'm going to do a tutor training in Rockland
for 16
next
years.
Saturday.
Yeah. I want to move back.
It's a good place.
It's beautiful up there.
But in this Rockland library, there was a tutor-learner pair that would work at a table, and there was one of the patrons of the library, he'd come in and wonder, what are those people doing? Whenever he'd come in, he'd see people, you know, he had no idea what they were doing there. So he asked the librarian, what's going on there? What are those people doing? And she told him, you know, about the library literacy program. Well, this was an elderly man who had quite a bit of money, and when he died, he left $500,000 to the literacy program. Yay! So, you know, that's one advantage.
Tell that to Charlie Jean.
That's one advantage, though, to having the tutor-learners pairs out where other people can see. I know that it does feel intimidating sometimes. And in Sacramento, we have some private places, and we encourage people not to meet in homes, but I've done that where I've met in homes.
I did that with a woman out there in the Rockland Library. I had two different tutors. I had one, I was helping her with her, she couldn't walk. Oh. So I was helping her walk into the library, and then we sit and learn how to read. Oh. So it's like we were both doing each other, but it was kind of confusing because, you know, you expect them to, you go in there, meet them, and work. But then I had this other lady, she was like higher up into the whatever call it, and we'd meet at her house. Mm-hmm. And she knew I was in and out of work and stuff, mm-hmm. so she offered me to do some work with the guy that was helping her do some stuff around. I just show up one time, and then she didn't want nothing to do with me.
Oh.
I was like, okay, well, next time I'm not getting involved in that stuff when it comes to my reading.
Yeah.
But no, the basic part of me is that it was really hard for me to go into the library and sit with everybody else that knows how to read mm-hmm. and not get looked upon. You know, your mind always says things to you.
Right. Well, ideally, you know, we have like a little cubicle. We have that in Sacramento where at the Sacramento Downtown Library, there's a little cubicles where you can meet, or they have tables off to the side and that kind of thing. But still, there's
it's changed a lot.
But the library, like I go in San Diego in Carlsbad, we just had a brand new, it's everybody, it's very nice. Then we had a cubicle and we meet one on one, it's very private, really nice. And just like, wow, it's really improved.
So is this helpful to you to know your grade level?
Yes and no. Yes, because at least I have one. And no, because you kind of feel like a failure that, oh, I'm only at fifth grade, or only I'm at third grade. And, you know, I'm looking at a six-year-old and I can read what he reads. So.
Well, now, as far as reading level goes, like the newspaper, most newspaper articles are rarely, unless you're at the opinion page or something, are rarely much above sixth grade.
Oh, really?
So actually, a sixth grade reading level is relatively good.
Pretty
good.
Do
you know what determines readability, reading level?
No, but I think more than reading is comprehending. I can read.
True, true. But they say the longer the word, the longer the sentence. Those are the two things that go together to determine readability level.
Oh, really?
Because there's formulas, you know, and I've done many of these. You count out 100 words. You choose, like, if you're finding the readability level of a particular book. And I did this, actually, telling my age here, but that's all right. When Nixon was president, and I was reading a book that he'd written. I forget the name of it.
You know what's so interesting, not to interrupt you, is but for someone who doesn't read, mm-hmm. Nixon doesn't mean anything to
okay,
me.
Well, he'd been one of our presidents. He's been a president.
History.
Okay. All right. When he was president, he had written this one book, My Six Crises, I think it was called. And then Pearl Buck, who had written, what was a famous book? She wrote about China. But anyway, I was reading those two books, and I was doing a readability study on those two. And what you do is you choose like a 100-word passage at the beginning of the book, and then the middle, and then the end, and you count out the number of syllables, the number of sentences, and then there's a special formula figure. Well, Nixon's book came out sixth grade, and the Chinese book was eighth.
Really?
Yeah. So I hate to really get involved in those numbers as far as your reading level goes, because I think what you're saying, when you're not afraid to read anymore, and, you know, I was a special ed teacher, and I think an awful lot of problem that so many of our learners have is that they have been so used to failure. Mm-hmm. And when they do find some success, they're kind of scared because failure is comfortable. And this man that I'm working with now, I know that's where he is. And we're trying to get past that. But he's so used to getting it wrong that when he gets it right, oh, is that really me? You know, and getting past that is really difficult. And the only thing I can figure is give him a lot more success. So thank you again very much.
I certainly enjoyed.
Thank you.